Hello, this is Lazarus at telecomTech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining the various components of MPLS traffic engineering. I strive to make complex telecom and networking technologies easy to understand and straightforward. If you appreciate my approach, don't forget to like, subscribe, and turn on notifications so you'll be the first to catch my latest content. As we have seen in the last couple of videos, MPLS traffic engineering employs a technique called constraint-based routing, which goes beyond traditional shortest path routing. Instead of simply choosing the shortest route, MPLS-TE selects optimized paths that meet specific criteria called constraints in MPLS jargon that you as an administrator define. To direct traffic along these optimized paths, MPLS-TE establishes unidirectional tunnels called label-switched paths. MPLS-TE gives you much more control as to what path data will take to ensure the absolute best use of the network infrastructure, bringing efficiencies as near to 100% as possible while maintaining SLAs as far as quality of service, reliability, and redundancy go. Now, to achieve all of this, MPLS-TE is comprised of these four specific components: the distribution of link information, path calculation, path setup using RSVP-TE, and finally, forwarding traffic through the established TE tunnels. We'll discuss each of these components in further detail. Now, this first component has to do with the distribution of link information. In order for MPLS-TE to determine the specific path that each LSP should take, there must be a way to distribute information about the states in which the various links throughout the topology are in. This is done using the underlying IGP. Specifically, it's performed by either OSPF or ISIS. Now, OSPF and ISIS are both link state routing protocols, and as such, they're properly suited to perform this function. Indeed, both of these protocols have been developed with traffic engineering extensions specifically designed to support MPLS-TE. These extensions advertise link attributes that are relevant to MPLS-TE. Now, these link attributes include things like link bandwidth attributes, and among them we have the total available bandwidth, the maximum reservable bandwidth, as well as the unreserved bandwidth. Then we also have customized TE metrics that can be configured, and these are independent of the more traditional IGP metrics used. Then we have administrative groups, also known as link coloring, which can be configured to represent specific link characteristics. Then we have link protection types, which indicate if a link is protected by mechanisms such as fast reroute, and an attribute called shared risk link groups, or SRLGs. These identify shared failure domains for TE planning. Now, link state routing protocols will store their information about routes in their link state database, or their LSDB. The TE extension to these routing protocols adds what is known as the Traffic Engineering Database, or the TED. It's the database that collects and maintains the traffic engineering information that has been learned by these TE extensions of the IGPs. Now, if you haven't dealt with MPLS-TE before, all of these constraints that I've mentioned may not be clear or fully understandable. And that's okay, not to worry about that. We'll be going more in depth into how they work and how they are applied in future videos. So the TE extensions of these IGPs take care of advertising and distributing the necessary TE information about links throughout the topology, storing them within the TED database. Now, the next component of MPLS-TE deals with using this collected link information that has been accumulated in the TED to calculate the necessary path through the topology. To determine this, we use the constrained shortest path first, or CSPF algorithm. This is an advanced version of the SPF algorithm used by link state protocols such as OSPF and ISIS. It's used to calculate the path an LSP should take taking into account the various constraints, as well as explicit path requirements that may have been configured. CSPF ensures that the chosen path meets the requirements of the configured traffic engineering policy. Now, these constraints can include the various link attributes that we talked about before that are stored in the TED, such as bandwidth requirements of the tunnel, available bandwidth on the interfaces, the setup and hold priorities of the TE tunnels, administrative groupings or link coloring, and explicit routes, which specify interfaces or routers that should be included or excluded from the path. Now, only head-end routers perform the CSPF algorithm, taking into account the information accumulated in their local TED and the configured constraints. The result of a CSPF calculation is an ordered list of IP addresses with next hops for the path of the TE tunnel. This essentially defines the path through the MPLS infrastructure. This ordered list is then used by our next component of MPLS-TE, which is the path setup using RSVP-TE. Now, this third component of MPLS-TE is comprised of the actual setup of the path. We've collected link states, we've stored them in the TED, we've run our CSPF on our head-end router, and we have an ordered list of IP addresses. Now we need a signaling protocol to reserve resources along the path to establish our LSP tunnel. Now, this is done using Resource Reservation Protocol Traffic Engineering, or the RSVP-TE protocol. Now, regular RSVP was originally designed to employ quality of service features on networks, but it never became widespread in use. However, with its traffic engineering extensions, it has become ideal for use with MPLS-TE. Now, using the ordered list of IP addresses determined by the CSPF algorithm, the head-end router will use RSVP-TE to signal the tunnel. RSVP-TE is responsible for the setup and maintenance of the path, the tearing down of the path, as well as dealing with errors that may arise. We'll talk in more detail about how the RSVP-TE protocol operates in a future video. Finally, we come to the fourth and final component of our MPLS-TE operation, which is the forwarding of traffic through the TE tunnels. Once RSVP establishes the LSP tunnel, it's just there. It doesn't really do anything until you route traffic through it. You can use conventional routing, such as static routing or policy-based routing, to route traffic through an MPLS-TE tunnel, or you can use some more advanced routing options that are specific to MPLS-TE, which give you more options and more flexibility. But we'll examine these options in upcoming videos. Now, one important detail to remember, and something I may not have emphasized enough before, is that LSP tunnels are unidirectional. They can carry data in only one direction. This means that for bidirectional traffic, you need to provision LSP tunnels in both directions. The return path might not be the same as the forwarding path because it can be influenced by different constraints or traffic engineering policies. Additionally, the network topology that the return traffic traverses will most likely have different characteristics and constraints than the one used for the forward traffic. Another key point is that LSPs are created by the head-end routers only. All the intelligence for setting up an LSP resides in the head-end router responsible for that tunnel, and as such, you must carefully plan and provision your LSPs to ensure traffic flows as expected and meets your network performance objectives. So that gives you an idea at a high level of the components involved in the operation of MPLS-TE and how they work to enable traffic engineering on MPLS topologies. For now, I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. If you have any questions or feedback, feel free to leave a comment below. I'm always happy to read them and to respond. And please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at telecomTech. I hope this has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.